to give a very warm welcome to Professor Nira Chamberlain. And without further ado, I'm going to hand over to you.
Okay, well, thank you very much indeed. And I'd like to say to all the students, because I believe you're international, so I have to say good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are in the world today. But the talk today is, what is the point of mathematics? And I'll last for about 40, 45 minutes, and there'll be plenty of time to ask questions at the end. Okay, what is the point of mathematics? So, sine, cos, tan, algebra. What is the point of mathematics? I go into schools, I do online talks, and this is a common question, a frequently asked question: sine, cos, tan, algebra. What is the point of mathematics? Now, to answer that question, I'm actually going to go back to an incident that happened in 2000. In 2000, when the world was a much more kind and much more friendlier place, what we had is that the Russians were doing some naval activity off this North Korea, and they had, let's say, a submarine called the Kursk. And the Kursk was decided to do this exercise where it wanted to do was fire a torpedo. But unfortunately, that torpedo never left the submarine and it actually exploded inside. Half the sailors died straight away, while the other half ran to the end of the submarine. The submarine sank 100 meters down to the bottom of the sea. And for a whole week, the world heard those Russian sailors banging on the side of the submarine, saying, "Let us out, let us out." But by the time a rescue was attempted and the hatch was open, unfortunately, there were no survivors. Now, despite the international effort and the international outcry by the public, experts have said, in a situation when a submarine goes down 100 meters and a rescue is impossible. Impossible. I'm going to quote you, give you this quote from Muhammad Ali, a famous boxer. He said this: "Impossible is just a word thrown around by small men and women who find it easier to live in a world they are being given than to explore the power they have changed to change it. Impossible is not a fact, it's an opinion. Impossible is a potential. Impossible is temporary. Impossible is nothing." My name is Nira Chamberlain, and this is my story. Now, I'm a mathematician, and in 2021, I was the president of the Institute of Mathematics and its Application. And in a couple of weeks' time, I'm actually going to become the president of the Mathematical Association. So I'll be the figurehead for the mathematics teachers in the United Kingdom. Now, what people say about mathematics, they tend to think about mathematics as a tool, especially if you want to be going to science, technology, engineering, yeah, and the STEM subjects. They think that mathematics, all you do is mathematics, is that you get a number, you put into the formula, and you get the answer. Here's the numbers, you put into a formula, and you get the answers. They see that mathematics is very much as a tool. But what we're talking about, especially when we're talking about STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, we're saying, is math really a tool? You know, what I'm going to do is give you a quote here from Katherine Johnson. She said this: "We will always have STEM with us. Some things will drop out from the public eye and will go away, but there will always be science, engineering, and technology, and there will always be mathematics." But I want to go beyond that. I am believing that actually mathematics is beyond a tool. Not only is it a tool, it's beyond a tool. My role is a mathematical modeler. Now, I am a mathematical modeler. So what does a mathematical modeler do? A mathematical modeler looks at a problem, any problem, and transform that problem into mathematics, solve it, and then apply that solution back into the real world. So that's what I do. I turn things into mathematics and solve it. Yeah. So, but when you come to the question, what is the point of mathematics? If you ask 100 different mathematicians, you will get 100 different answers. But for me, as a mathematical modeler, what is the point of mathematics? Is to understand, to predict, and to influence the world that surrounds us. So here, I want to give you a little quote from Albert Einstein. And he said this, that mathematics is the poetry of logical ideas. So what I'm going to do is give you an example where I've used mathematics as the poetry of logical ideas. One day, I was approached by a Royal Navy captain. And he said this to me, he said, "Nira, we have a future ship that is very expensive to build, but unaffordable to run. Is there a mathematical way to solve this problem?" And I said, okay, have you ever heard the story Goldilocks and the Three Bears? And he says, you what? I said, yeah, Goldilocks and the Three Bears. You see, Goldilocks, she goes into the house, she sees this porridge, she said, this is too hot, this is too cold, or this is just right. And that is how you solve your problem. There you go. And he just looked at me and he walked away and I didn't see him again for 2 weeks. 2 weeks later, he came to me and said, Nira, would you like to follow me? So I followed him into a room that looked like this. And I said, hello. And they said, hello back to me. And I said, what is this meeting all about? And they said, well, this meeting is about us cancelling this future ship project. I said, okay. And they said, well, and we've heard that you've come up with a potential solution. I said, okay. And they said, would you like to tell us about it? And I said, right. Have you heard the story Goldilocks and the Three Bears? And they says, we beg your pardon. I said, yeah, Goldilocks and the Three Bears. See, Goldilocks, she goes to the house, she sees this porridge, it says, this is too hot, this is too cold, well, this is just right. I see, and that's how you solve your problem. There you go. And this is what they said to me. They says, do you realize that this project is of national interest and you are talking about some sort of nursery rhyme? And I said, okay, whoa. Let me be a bit more specific. What you need to do with that ship is that you need to link its costs to its capability to its design. And what that does, it creates a whole series of nonlinear mathematical equations. Now you put that onto a computer and write an algorithm that says, design me a ship that's not too hot, not too cold, just right. And there you will get a ship that is affordable. And actually, in the last 2 weeks, that's what I've been doing. And this is my solution I come up with. And I showed it to them and they looked at it and they went like this. They went, oh, actually, we think that that might actually work. Yeah. See, now that was over 15 years ago. See, the question is, would you like to see what a ship looks like today?
I must admit, I held my breath as she came here through the harbour entrance because it's so small.
We're a proud Navy family coming here to see the ship going in. My husband had worked on the programme, so it's been kind of a lot of our lives. In fact, our wedding cake was the Queen Elizabeth carrier.
It was brilliant, worth waiting for. It's a brilliant experience.
It'll take some time to build up the operating envelope and our understanding of the complexity of operating a ship of this scale. But we've done a lot in preparation for that, working with both the French and the United States Navy.
Now, that was the HMS Queen Elizabeth, the largest aircraft carrier that the Royal Navy has ever had. Now, somewhere on that ship, there is a placard and it says Dr. Nira Chamberlain, and it will remain there for the next 50 years. So that is me using mathematics as the poetry of logical ideas. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you about a bit of my personal journey, how I when I was born in the inner city of Birmingham and how my journey to become a professional mathematician. Now, I grew up in a city called Birmingham, which is the second city of the United Kingdom. And when I was about, let's say, 7 or 8, all my friends were into Batman, Superman, Spider-Man. But with me, I like picking up a calculator and pressing the buttons until they all flashed at me. And so when I was about 15, I really wanted to do a career that involved mathematics and logic. So when I went to the career teacher and spoke to him about this, he says this to me. He said, Nira, somebody of your physique, you should become a boxer. I said, a boxer? And he said, you should become a boxer. So I went home and I told my parents, I said that the career teacher thinks that I should become a boxer, so maybe I should become a boxer. And then my parents, especially my dad, he gave me this advice. He says this, Nira, you don't need anybody's permission to be a great mathematician. And I say it again, you don't need anybody's permission to be a great mathematician. See, that is what my dad said to me. And I'll say that to you, everybody out there, you don't need anybody's permission to be a great mathematician. So with me, I went on, did my GCSEs, did my A-levels, did my degree, did my master's. But I also started getting more interested in mathematicians out there. What was their motivations? What was their attitude? And I came across this gentleman here. His name is Cedric Vanelli. He's one of the greatest mathematicians in the world. He's a French mathematician. Now, he wrote a book, and it's about, you know, who are mathematicians? And he said this: a mathematician is not necessarily those who find mathematics easy. I say again, a mathematician is not necessarily those who find mathematics easy. A mathematician are those who see problems and never, ever quit. That's a mathematician. So no matter how, no matter whether you're at the top or average or wherever you are, a mathematician is not somebody that finds mathematics easy. A mathematician is somebody that sees a problem and never, ever quits. That's a mathematician. And with that, I got really encouraged about that when I said all these leading mathematicians would say the same things. A mathematician is somebody that sees a problem and never, ever quits. And they're thinking, well, I see a problem and I don't quit. So I can be a mathematician. Yeah. So after my master's, I decided to go out and work out in industry. But in industry, they were quite negative towards mathematics. They thought that there are problems too complicated for mathematics to be applied to. But with me, I said, I'm a mathematician and I see a problem and I never ever quit. And so henceforth, I started to have a successful mathematical modeling career, where what I'd do is go all around Europe doing the mathematics that scientists and engineers would find challenging. I worked on things like volcanoes, oil rigs, airplanes, helicopter boats, yes? But there was one time I was asked to stop an oil pipeline from exploding. And then another time I was asked to stop planes from falling out of the sky all around the world. And one of the most interesting problems I've been working on was one time I was asked to stop an artificial intelligence apocalypse. But that is another presentation. But one of my most interesting problems was to do with Formula One. And what the problem was is that with a Formula One, you had, let's say, the car, the main body of the car, and it's linked to the wheels. Now, if the wheels was rotating too slowly, it could start locking and would fly off. And the Formula One team would see that this was a problem. But the people that actually designed the wheel locks and the chassis they used two different types of programs, and the programs wasn't compatible to each other. So I was asked to solve this problem using mathematics. And I was thinking, well, what is the quickest way to change a computer program? And I thought, because I had to do this in a short time, and I thought the quickest way to change a computer program is to write a computer virus. So I wrote a computer virus that changed the car components program so that we could embed it into the Formula One simulation. We did that, and it was that team successfully won the championship that season. So because of my mathematical activity working out in industry, in 2014, I was recognized as one of the leading UK scientists by the Science Council, and I was recognized for developing mathematical modeling applications for industry. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you how I would go about putting a mathematical modeling together. But to do that, I need a help from a pirate from the Caribbean. Okay, hidden treasures. 10 years ago, Jack Sparrow hid 5 gold coins on a large desert island. However, he has forgotten where he has buried it. All he can remember is where he started from and that he buried the first coin after 20 hours of walking, the rest after 40, 60, 80, and 100 hours of walking respectively. So if we look at that, the question is where are the gold coins buried? Now, if we think about that, we can think, well, even if we just said, right, there's Jack Sparrow walks at a certain average speed, certainly a gold coin would be located somewhere on the circumference of that circle. But there's a complication. Jack said this: I might have changed direction after walking for an hour. I say again, I might have changed direction after walking for an hour. So what he says is this, that he would walk for 1 hour, he would forget which direction he would go in, and then he would pick up his compass and he would choose one of these 8 directions, either north, northwest, west, southwest, south, southeast, east, or northeast. And it would go in one of those directions after every hour. So the question is, can we work out where those gold coins are buried? So what we do is that we do something called the random walk, where what we do is that we actually simulate all these different scenarios and we'll repeat it over and over again. And what, by doing that, we create what's called a probability field, the probability that the gold coins are located in a certain location. So by doing a simulation and doing what's called the random walk, we get this result. After 20 hours, we get where the red areas is where the probability is low, and the green areas is where the probability is higher. So this is after 20 hours of walking. This is after 40 hours of walking. This is after 60 hours of walking, 80 hours of walking, and 100 hours of walking. Now, if we just take a strip through that region, what we find is that in terms of the location of those coins, more than likely that those coins are probably located very close to where Jack Sparrow actually started walking from. Yeah. But interestingly, using this random walk, the good news for Captain Jack Sparrow is that our search area has been reduced by 84%. Now, this may sound like a very comical example, but there's actually a serious application. On the 8th of March in 2014, the plane MH370 left Kuala Lumpur to go to Beijing. After 45 minutes, it disappeared from the radar. And ever since, we've been searching for those planes ever since. Now, at first, people assumed that this was a mechanical fault and it was a ghost plane, and they were searching in a certain area using those assumptions. However, a number of scientists have recognized that possibly this is to do with human factors, maybe the pilot or some people on the plane that wanted to make that plane to disappear. By using that logic, what we're trying to do is that we're working out, using the random walk, a new probability field for where we now can actually look and search for that plane. So now this work is still ongoing. Okay, next one, the financial crisis of 2008. Now, in 2008, there was a world economical crash, yes, and it was caused by the banks. And see, now the banks, they do use mathematical models. They use financial mathematical models. But the problem was, is that these mathematical models never predicted the world economical crash. It came as a surprise to everybody. Now, because of this, we have this gentleman here, whose name is Professor Michael Kitson, who's at Cambridge University. And he said this: "I am not convinced that the failure of mathematical economics can be repaired by doing more maths. Economics needs to stop clinging to the notion that the complexity of human behavior can be explained by algorithms or mathematical proof." When he said that, this problem came onto my desk. And there was a certain theory called emergence theory, called this, where what we said is this: instead of modeling at the macro level, at the highest level, model collection of individual entities at the micro level and see what emerges. I say again, instead of modeling at the macro level, model the collection of individual entities at the micro level and see what pattern emerges. Yes. And so this is an example of emergence theory done by John Conway, called The Game of Life, where what is it do? They have a certain number of rules down at the micro level and you see what emerges at the macro level. So in terms of our exam, in terms of the financial crash, what does that mean? The macro is the risk of a world economical crash. The micro is actually the behavior of the individual banks and So the question is, can we model the bank's behavior instead of the risk? And by modeling the bank's behavior, do we see a world economical crash emerges? So now, one of the things that we've done is that if we look at an old mathematical theorem called the gambler's ruin problem, which is the mathematics of competition, and we could actually use this to model the bank's behavior. Yeah, but we wanted to actually mimic the 2008 behavior, so we had to extend this mathematical theorem. Yeah, and when we did this, this was the result. The x-axis represents the risk that was taken, and the y-axis represents the proportion of world banks that becomes bankrupt. And as you can see, when we start around about 100 and start moving along, the number of banks that actually be bankrupt remains quite flat. And then we reach a critical point where all of a sudden there is a sudden jump. This part actually represents a world economical crash. Yeah. However, people were a bit wanted to challenge this and saying, but can human microbehavior really change an environmental state? And so what we're going to do is that we're going to do an experiment to show if we change humans' microbehavior, we can actually change the environmental state. So the question is, can we change a railway station, a train railway station, into a dance hall? By changing some microbehavior, can we change a railway station full of commuters into a dance hall? This is a normal train station and full of commuters. And then all of a sudden, we're going to play some music. And then what we're going to do, we're going to introduce some more dancers. And then there you can see a commuter who's thinking about dancing. And then we're changing the music to appeal to people's different tastes. And now we're going to send in the last set of dancers. Now this is the commuter now becomes a dancer. The commuter now becomes a dancer. And then she goes, come on, join in. And he goes, all right then. And he joins in. That becomes a dancer. Commuter now becomes a dancer. And now you can't even see who the original dancers are. All the commuters are dancing. Now look what happens when the music starts. Everybody become commuters. So from that, what we can see is by changing microbehavior, you can see what patterns emerges. The same thing that happened here, where we turned a train station into a dance hall, is the same thing what happened when with the banks. When you changed the bank's behavior, it caused a world economical crash. So yes, we can. Now, next case, mathematics versus COVID-19. Now, in 2020, in this country, what we had is that we're talking about COVID coming into the shores of the United Kingdom from Europe. And back then, this was before vaccination, and the government was trying to think of what can we do to tackle COVID-19. And amazingly, the things that they were saying back in 2020 was, oh, we believe that this is, you only can get COVID just once. And so what we need to do is that we need to do something called herd immunity. As once you get it once, then you won't be able to get it again. And so just let it come, let COVID come into the UK and everything will be okay. But there was a number of scientists and mathematicians who were working on this problem thinking, but we think that that is actually an unsafe problem. Because really and truly, when you're talking about the way that we model and use mathematics to describe a infectious disease, we usually say like this, suspect infectious recovery, and then which represented certain groups, and then you have a group of data. So you have a group that suspect, and they could move to being infectious, they could move to recovery, and of course you have those who sadly pass away. But that is the normal way that you model an infectious disease. But COVID was something completely novel, saw it completely different. See, COVID didn't look like this. COVID actually looked like something like this, something which was even much more complex than anything that we had ever encountered before. Now, by actually doing this, we wanted actually to look at the government, the UK's government policy of saying, you know, herd immunity. And we're saying, oh, now, if we looked at, let's say, herd immunity, they say that really and truly, when COVID comes to the UK, actually what will happen is that it will increase and it will decrease, and that will happen because you cannot get COVID twice. But we're saying, well, if that's an unsafe assumption, but let's say you are wrong, you can actually get COVID multiple times, then actually you move to a situation more like this, where the number of deaths could increase by almost 108%, yes? And even if you actually implemented this whole idea of you can catch COVID multiple times, but you implement hand washing for 20 seconds, you still increase the number of deaths by 63%. But what you needed to do was implement almost like a New Zealand style early social distancing to actually combat this this possibility that you can get COVID multiple times, yeah? And so by doing that, if we calculated that the deaths could actually be decreased by almost 85%, yeah, over 85%. So we're looking at this idea of social distancing. So what I did is I created this experimental mathematical model to demonstrate the effectiveness of social distancing. And it goes like this.
Okay. Today, we're going to demonstrate a mathematical modeling experiment of social distancing. What we have here are two rows of dominoes. This one is not doing social distancing. This one is doing social distancing. Look what happens when the first domino has coronavirus. Everybody gets coronavirus. Look what happens when this domino gets coronavirus. Social distancing works.
And so henceforth, we was actually applying this as a strategy until we could get the vaccine could actually be tested and actually could be distributed across the population. Cool. So the big internet mass off. Now, in 2018, 16 mathematicians from around the world was invited to take part in an international mathematics communication competition. And the rules of the competition was this, is that we was all split up into twos. And what we had to do is two mathematicians, they had to put up something interesting about mathematics up onto the internet, and the general public would vote for which mathematical video or subject did they find the most interesting. The one that gets the most votes after 48 hours would move it to the next round. And so henceforth, you'd go from round one, round two, semifinal, and into the final. Now, I was fortunate enough to go from round one to round two into the semifinals, and I made it into the finals. Now, when I was in the finals, I was up against a certain mathematician named Matt Parker, who is a very brilliant mathematician, brilliant math communicator. And I would say to the organizers when they actually invited me first, saying, well, why are you inviting me? Because I'm a mathematical modeler. I only do math communication, you know, now and again. But they said, well, you're an interesting mathematician and, you know, we want you to take part in this competition. And I said, well, what do I present? And they said to me, I could present anything I wanted to present, as long as it's to do with mathematics. So I made it to the final. So I decided to do a talk on mathematical modeling. So what I did, not only did I do the talk general mathematical modeling, I wanted to show them a surprising application of mathematics to a real world problem. So what I'm going to show you next is actually my submission for the final of the big internet mathematics competition. And if I win it, you are named as the world's most interesting mathematician.
My name is Dr. Nira Chamberlain, and I'm a professional mathematical modeler. Now, in the mathematical modeling community, there's a saying, if you go down deep enough into anything, you will find mathematics. Have a look at this video called Real World Mathematics.
Okay, right, and with that, I was named as the world's most interesting mathematician. So, final words. What is the point of mathematics? Now, I'm going to quote a Nobel Prize winning physicist, Richard Feynman, and he said this: in order to understand the world around us, it is necessary to have a deeper understanding of mathematical relationships. So, at the beginning of this talk, I talked to you about a Russian submarine that fired a torpedo, which exploded, and it sank to the bottom of the sea, and all the sailors died on the seafloor. And there was a public outcry, but the experts said a solution was impossible. That was in August 2005. Now, and I gave you this quote from Omar Dali saying that impossible is temporary, impossible is nothing. Now, in April 2005, there was a mathematician named Nira Chamberlain that stood up in front of all of these military mathematicians and says this: guess what? The reason why there has never been a successful rescue of a submarine in the past is based on something called the Goldilocks principle. Either you've gone in too hot, too cold, but not just right. Either your rescue vehicles have been too big or too small, but there is a Goldilocks zone where you need to design a rescue vehicle that is in between, and that in with that one you actually increase the probability of saving life. And what I did is I did a simulation of the curse, and it showed that actually using the Goldilocks principle, we could actually have saved those people on that submarine. Now, that was April 2005, but in August 2005, a British team using the Goldilocks principle actually rescue a crew of Russian sailors in a submarine, yeah, using the Goldilocks principle. So what is the point of mathematics? The point of mathematics is to do the impossible. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to end this talk with a video to show that you are the future of mathematics. Thank you very much indeed for listening.
Amazing. There's lots of hands going up. The mics are off, but there are loads of hands going up. That's absolutely incredible and quite moving, actually. So I know that we will have quite a lot of questions for you. So, sir, can you see folks' hands being raised, or I can chair questions for you?
Oh, I think you can chair questions for me. So,
well, we've got Bo, would you like to ask your question?
But hi, I love maths, by the way. I just have a question. What would you say to someone who said the maths you learn in school isn't helpful in the real world?
Yeah, I mean, the maths that you learn in to school is definitely it's laying the foundations for what you need to do in the future. It's, you know, everybody needs to be good at numeracy, pure and simple. And from numeracy, you move on to, let's say, to algebra, and then algebra, then you're going to move on to do your calculus and your statistics. So you know, what you do in school is definitely important. So don't underestimate numeracy. Do not underestimate algebra. Do not underestimate statistics. And just tell them, absolutely, guess what? Mathematics is indisputably the greatest subject in the world. So, yes, it is relevant. Okay?
Excuse me, sir. I just want to say, I once wasn't really a huge fan of this subject because I thought it was just a bunch of numbers which were really hard to calculate. But now, you've entirely changed my world opinion of it.
Oh, thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Oh, thank you.
Well done, Daniel. Do we have any more questions from our students? I know we've got quite a few maths buffs in. They might have been stunned into silence.
There's a couple really long questions in the chat.
Oh, Flavia, do you want to read them out, Flavia?
Oh, sure, I can read them out.
Yeah, go for it.
Okay, Kahoy has a few questions. Number one, what are some advice that you could give to young people interested in publishing works on mathematics?
Oh, okay. There's two ways you can actually do it. One of the easiest ways if you want to publish work is, you know, do a blog or do a V blog, that's one of the ways to do it. Or if you want to go down more than, let's say, the official route, submit your ideas to a journal, to whatever mathematical society there are in your country, and they will look at it, and if they find it interesting, they will publish it. But that doesn't stop you from actually submitting something on social media and saying, I've got this idea, away we go. So it's all good. So
another question from the same person is, if one day all the knowledge we have on maths would vanish completely from our minds, what would be one fact, one piece of information that you would think we could keep in order to rebuild everything we had?
1 + 1 = 2.
Very funny.
I think that's fair enough. I think I have one more question, if that's all right. And my question was, as you said, that you, I mean, I'm sure you as a mathematician, you look at all these science fiction and fantasy pieces of media and you think, this is ridiculous, you know, this is not how this would work in reality. But just like the Black Panther suit that you drew inspiration from, do you think that there are some fictional concepts which are feasible with what we have now?
Yeah, I mean, there's some fictional concepts. I mean, you know, what you have, let's say, in mathematics, you have something called conjecture and you have proof. Sometimes what you find in these films, they come in with all these conjectures. Now, some of them you're thinking, no, not a chance. But some of them you're thinking, actually, that's interesting. And then when you actually go down and you start doing the mathematics and the engineering from it, away we go. I mean, a prime example is Star Trek. I mean, Star Trek was done in the 1960s, and they had like this communication equipment that looked very much like a mobile phone of today. So yeah, away we go.
Looking to see if we have any other questions coming in. More in the chat coming. Keep going, Flavia. You're doing a better job than me.
Adeline's got a question there, Flavia.
Yeah, Adeline just asked, what is your favorite area of maths now? Are there any areas that particularly stood out to you when you were learning them as a child?
I think I liked probability. I liked statistics. Then I was moving much to the applied and the simulation. But I very much, as a mathematical modeler, I tend to like all types of mathematics. Everything that's mathematics, I like.
I actually have a question that always preys on my mind. So if you take a big problem like a medical problem like cancer, do you think there's a role for, I don't know, people who think differently about the problem to come in and help, you know, microbiologists or whoever those experts are? So a mathematician's input into that. Can that,
Yes. I mean, there's always when we're talking about complex problems are solved by diverse thinking. You know, sometimes we always approach a problem in one way, but by actually coming at different angles and having different people thinking in different ways and combining it together and coming in a hybrid way, that's when you stand the better chance of solving those problems. And actually would include cancer in that. I mean, nowadays they are using AI machine learning to see other things that we've seen in their patterns that the medical profession haven't seen before. Now, I'm not saying that that's the absolute solution, but it's just adding, you know, coming from a different perspective. Yeah.
One more quick question for me, a very quick one on the back of using AI. As an English specialist, I think AI doesn't have the imagination to do what we do. Does AI have the imagination to do what a mathematician does?
Never.
There you go. Brilliant. Kai, Conrad, you've got a question there. I'll read it out for you. A slightly random one, but how would you describe your life or career if you cannot use any calculus or differential equations? Am I understanding the question correctly?
What would my life be like without mathematics? I think it would certainly be different. There was this joke that one time. So let me. And that will probably answer your question by me telling you this joke. Yeah, once upon a time, there was this person, and he came across a genie, and the genie said to this person, he goes, "I will grant you 3 wishes." And then the person says, "Okay, my first wish is I wish that mathematics didn't exist." And the genie goes, "Right, done." And then the person says, "What about my next wish?" I says, "Sorry."
I'm laughing. We've got Hina with her hand up.
So I wanted to ask, who was your inspiration when you were younger to become a mathematician, or was it just by yourself?
I think it was. I was just interested in the subject, but as I grew older, as I was going through my teenage. And as I'm going through my teenage years and going through university, like I knew about Katherine Johnson way before Hidden Figures. Do you know what I mean? So Katherine Johnson was a role model. Yeah.
And we've got Daniel.
And this is the last question from me. But for years, I basically wanted to be a designer. Architect and a car designer. I've been wanting to do that for a few years now. So I just would like to say that I think I'd either use a calculator or a few assistants to, like, you know, advise me for all these mathematical calculations until I, you know, graduate and build a prototype and stuff.
Okay, and so, I mean, you know, if you want to be, let's say, a designer and an architect, I mean, there will be mathematics involved in that. And, you know, like I think what I said in that video, if you go down deep enough into editing, you'll find mathematics. But if you want to be a designer and an architect, you know, my advice for you, Daniel, is go for it. If that's your dream, then chase it, you know, and don't give up on it. Do you know what I mean?
That's what I'm doing.
Be a designer, be an architect, yeah. And I look forward to seeing that building or that new car that designed by you in the future. So just go for it.
Hopefully, I'll get you one with like mathematical paintings on it.
I'll be honoured.
Claire Enriquez, what's your question?
Have you ever had a favorite subject that wasn't math at one point? If so, what was it, and how did it beat math?
You're so funny.
So did I have a subject that wasn't mathematics? Yes, I used to play a clarinet and then music, but again, then that involved fractions, so I suppose that was mathematics, so away we go.
We've got a teacher with her hand up. Mrs. Graham, what did you want to ask?
Hello, I know I'm old and I know I see things very differently, Professor Chamberlain, but I wanted to say to you, when I was taught maths, my maths teacher was, you know, of a type, can you remember, in the old days, and they never bridged maths into life. And I was thinking, do you think there's room for teacher trainers, maths teacher trainers, to be taught how to bridge things better so that children can understand the way you've done this talk today, which was amazing. You're a fab man. The way you've made maths come alive today, and you've shown aspects that I hadn't got a clue about. Mathematical modelling, sorry, didn't know that, biology teacher here. But a need for that to be upgraded within the maths curriculum so that children are understanding why they're doing what they're doing, because when children understand, children learn better.
I thank you for that. Because one of the, like I said, in a few weeks' time, I'm going to become the president of the Mathematical Association, and I'm supposed to be having a theme. And one of my theme is going to be, my theme actually is, what is the point of mathematics? And I'll be talking about saying, look, you know, when somebody says to me, you know, if the child said to you or pupils to say, what is the point of mathematics? Sometimes we say, oh, how mathematics has been used in the past. But what we don't do is tell them how mathematics is going to be used in the near future. So when all of these wonderful students in front of us, when they're in their 20s and 30s, how will they be actually be using mathematics in the near future? Now, in the near future, what's going to happen is that you're going to have a rise of AI. You're going to have AI making decisions all over the place. Now, does that mean that we're going to be using mathematics more or less? Guess what? It actually means that we're going to be using mathematics more, because with an AI system, AI systems today are still unreliable. And guess what? AI systems in the future will still be unreliable. So henceforth, we will need people that know mathematics, that know how to test it, know how to support it, and know how to challenge it. So for instance, you know, and the prime example is that algorithm that was used a number of years ago that says, oh, in the United Kingdom, that says, oh, if you are at a certain school, you get this certain A-level grade, you know. Unfortunately, those things are going to happen more and more often. Now, unless you're grounded in mathematics and empowered by mathematics, away we go. So I completely agree with you. And that is something that I want to do, really a theme that I wanted to go forward with. So thank you for that that view. And that gives me confirmation that I'm moving in the right direction.
Absolutely. And sorry, one more thing, kids, bear with, because I am old, but I am interested, hugely interested, apart from which I'm married to a mathematician and I have a little nerd boy who's brilliant at maths too. I also wanted to say my generation are very interested in all of this, but we are getting lost on the way. Is there any forum for you to create BBC programmes for everybody so we can actually understand the way forward? The children are being taught, they're part of the future. I'm 50 now, I'm old. I want to understand more, maybe to look at developing things and programmes where we're actually learning together and developing together. I think would be fascinating. And I wondered if you would have any say or any push in that direction.
Yes, I mean, certainly. Send me an email. Let's talk about that. Send me an email. That sounds very interesting. I mean, I keep getting, sometimes I get people from the media that says, oh, what's your ideas, or what's your ideas? But I think that's a fantastic idea. Send me an email, because I want to give you, I want to cite you, you know, not saying I'm claiming this idea, I want to cite you so that we can actually have a talk with the media people and see how far we can take that forward.
That'd be fabulous. Thank you so much for your time. You're wonderful. Thank you
very much indeed.
I'll pass that on to you, Mrs. Graham. Matthew, you've got a question.
Have you ever found maths hard at any point?
Ooh. Yes, all the time. All the time, you know, like, remember my quote, a mathematician is not somebody that finds mathematics easy. A mathematician is somebody that sees a problem and never quits. So the key thing is, do I find math hard? Yes. But do I quit? No.
Brilliant. And Hina? Oh, Hina's disappeared.
I was going to ask the same question as Matthew.
Well, there was a very similar question from someone else, which was, what can you do to become better at maths?
Okay, the key thing to I mean, you have to see, let's say, math, it's almost like speaking to a, let's say, a musician. If you say to a musician, if they play like a trumpet or the clarinet or the guitar, you know, you give them the guitar, how do you become a better guitarist or musician? It's called practice, practice, practice. Do you know what I mean? It's the quantity and the quality of the questions that you go for. Do you know what I mean? And you must be have this enthusiasm of going after problems and doing the problems and doing more problems and doing more problems. And then when you get it wrong, you're saying, why did I get it wrong? Was it a numerical mistake or was it an assumptions? And then and getting that research or saying, I'm reading math books, I'm looking at the techniques, I'm looking on YouTube. You know, that's how it's that having that inquisitive, you know, enjoying the battle. You know, that is how you become better in mathematics. Do you know what I mean? It's that constant practicing, rehearsing, doing questions, reading about mathematics. Yeah, that's how you become better at mathematics.
And I imagine there's nothing better than a light bulb moment when a penny drops.
Oh yeah, the penny drops, and the you know, that is only part of the journey. It's all of the journey that's enjoyable.
Fantastic. Well, I don't have any more hands up, so if nobody has another question, it just remains for us to say a very big thank you to you, Nira. Really, honestly, I think I shouldn't say this, but one of the best presentation I've seen in those slides. Amazing, and very moving, actually. Fantastic. Superb. So I can see some hands clapping. Thank you so much. I'm sorry we're all muted at the moment, but there are hands clapping. And have a wonderful evening, and thank you so much for coming to our school. We really appreciate it.
No problem.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you so much. You're amazing. I really love it. I could talk about maths for ages, and I'm not very clever and very good at maths.